Because you don't send people out to reach people for Jesus without the tools that they need to reach people for Jesus. And so, the reason we do BGMC is so that the missionaries can receive the curriculum, the material, the equipment they need in order to be effective for the gospel. And so that is what we're doing. And let's see, we have kids today that are you guys going to come and you can go around and pick up glasses? You know that last month you guys were here now. In fact, I had to collect money for the credit. Can you believe that? I don't look much like a boy, too. Let's pray over there so we're only going to have the kids come and help me with this. Lord Jesus, I just thank you this morning for allowing us to take up this offering, to collect the money for equipment and curriculum and the tools that our missionaries need to be effective to the Lord. I just thank you for the opportunity of being involved with what they are doing. Amen. Amen. All right, kids, if you like to, girls are here. Boys are over here. Why don't you come? And we're going to set these buckets out. Jennifer, can you set that bucket out? All right. They are going to go through. The people have the money, and they'll hold it up. They'll hold it up, and you go get it and put it in the girls' bucket. They'll let you know if you have girls, raise your hand. They'll come collect it. Go ahead and go collect it. There's something for the girls right there. Go collect it. Go ahead. They want you to go get it from them. Yes. Yes. God bless you all, and thank you for your generosity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We lift you up, Lord Jesus, we pray. Thank you that you have died that we can live, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have healed us. Thank you, Lord, that you have provided for us. We praise you that you strengthen us. Thank you, Lord, that you never present help. You never left this forsaken.
thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you do glorify you this morning. You are the best. There is nothing to thank you. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you accept those who are still in need of River Town this morning, Lord, that you would be with them and come to body. Lord, if there's a body this morning, that you would be with her as well. I pray, Lord, that you would be with all of us. I pray that you would heal their bodies, for you are the God that healeth us. You are our great physician. Lord Jesus, we also pray for those who are in need and want to pray that you provide for them. I just pray that you be glorified, and I pray that you would be lifted up in our midst. So, Lord Jesus, you said if you be lifted up, you will draw all men to yourself. That is our anxiety of the Lord, that you are. Lord Jesus, I just pray for each one here. I pray that you would minister to them, that you be glorified in them, that you would draw each of us to a closer experience of the relationship with you. In your precious name. Would you like to shake hands with somebody? Come, God is great. God is great. Shake hands. Greet one another this morning. Children, we may be dismissed to go to Genesis Children's Church with Miss Jennifer. Susan has something she would like to share with you. And go ahead, Susan.
So I've been really talking with the Lord and at prayer meeting and with the people here. And my big goal is to give my 5 children to the Lord and just start always thinking about their salvation. And I came up to the altar and I tend to praise and worship and think about them. And God is just telling me to think about Him and not anyway. So I have 5 children and 2 grandkids, and they were all on my back in this business. And as I was taking them up, it was heavy and it was difficult. But when I got up there to Jesus' feet, they started to fall off. No, Lord, no, we have to carry them. And he said, no, you have to worship me. So if I laid down to worship, all the kids that fell off of me down and worship him too. And I just praise God.
Let nothing hinder you from praising God. So we're going to be blessed this morning by God. He's coming. And the ushers are coming in a second, in a moment, but I would like to acknowledge first, I would like to acknowledge today is September 11th. Do you remember where you were on that day? Do you remember where you were on that day? I do. That is a day that is in infamy in our nation. And you do realize that even after all these years, there are people that are still struggling, still people that are sick, still people that are in grief. Because of that happened on that day. We are a little bit less affected because we live on the other side of the United States. And so, but those of you north and surrounding areas, it is still a very significant pain today. So I'd like to take this opportunity to pray for them and also to pray for America that God would return to them and God would bless. For he has said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and call on him. Lord Jesus, I just thank you this morning. And I praise you that you're Almighty God and that there is nothing out of your control. I pray for these who are still affected by this terror attack, Lord, that occurred these years ago. And there were promises made then that we would never forget. And Lord, so we want to remember. And Lord, I just pray that you would call your people to humble themselves and repent. And Lord, to turn from our wicked ways so that you might bless them. So that you might heal our bodies. But I just pray that you heal heart, mind, and soul, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings that we enjoy as being a part of this nation. I pray that you would bless America, but I also pray that America would bless you. We worship you. All right, Dale, now the ushers, please come. Yes? No. Dale, the rest is our concern.
Thank you for the opportunity to give out the message of the kingdom for the ages and growth and beyond the ages. Just thank you for all the efforts for the time to give out the message of the kingdom. I'm going to go to the next one.
applies the term to Romans chapter 16. The second doxology that we will discuss this morning, last week was Romans 11. This time, Romans 16, starting in verse 25. Now to him who is able to establish you in accordance with my gospel, the message I proclaim about Jesus Christ, in keeping with the revelation of the mystery hidden long ago, but now revealed and made known to the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all the Gentiles may come to the obedience that comes from faith. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, bless your word, open our hearts and ears that we might hear from you. I pray that you be glorified in your precious name. We are looking at some of the doxologies of the New Testament now. Last week we said, and I'll remind you, doxology is nothing. It's an exclamation of praise to God. It's an exclamation of praise. You have probably uttered a doxology in that you're about your business. Something fantastic happens. You become aware that God has done something great. And you simply say, well, praise God. And you don't even say that at all. It's an exclamation of praise. Paul intended to be a little bit more involved because Rob was Paul. So we have looked at the exclamation of praise of the doxology that is found in Romans 11. And in that doxology, Paul is praising God for his unsearchable wisdom. How great is our God. We discussed that if you go out to the ocean and look at you're standing on the beach and you look out, you're not even seeing 1% of the Pacific Ocean. That's how big the ocean is. You can't grasp how big the ocean is by looking on from the shore. You can't grasp how big the ocean is. That's how great our God is. The one who created the heavens, the sun, the moon, the stars, put them in place, calls them by name. How great is our God? How unsearchable is his wisdom? This time, today, the close of Romans, Paul again gives praise to God. But this time, Paul is praising God, for God is able. Is there anything that our God cannot do? Well, we can't sing. I've been asked that crazy question. Can God build a rock so big he can't touch it? Well, that's kind of a crazy question. Because he's the infinite God, and in his greatness, he can build all things. He can do all things. But he also has all power, so it's one of those things. In all things, God is able, and perhaps you are facing something this morning that you feel like is impossible. Well, I assure you this morning that God is able. Whatever you're facing, whether it be sickness or need or whatever, it doesn't matter. Our God is able to do more than you could ever possibly imagine. God is able. God is able. Now to him who is able. But specifically, verse 25, for God who is able to establish you in accordance with the gospel. With the gospel that Paul had preached to them, God is able to establish us. God is able to establish you in Christ Jesus.
you say, well, I have tried to live for him while in your life. You can't do it by yourself. You have to do it in his power, for he is able to establish you. You can't do it. You can't do it without him. It takes change. In chapter 1, verse 11, Paul expresses his desire to go to the Romans and to impart to them some spiritual gifts so that they might be more established in Christ. That's why you come this morning, so that you can grow in Christ, so you can learn from the Word, so that you can thrive in Christ, so that this can be true of you, so that he is for a God who is able to establish you in accordance with my gospel, the message I proclaim about Jesus Christ, in keeping with the revelation of the mysteries of God's Word. You understand that you are established by God according to his Word. As you put God's Word in your heart, you are established in God. You're established in Christ. And that's why we meet together and study together and pray one another and pray for one another. And that's what it's all about in the body. In the body, God is able. In fact, the key verse to the book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 16, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. It's the power of God unto salvation. It is God who is able to save us, to forgive us, to redeem us, to establish us. But then it is our privilege to develop that relationship with him. But it is God who is able to establish us. You know that the power, without the power of God, there is no salvation. You realize that without the power of God, you can't be saved or forgiven or redeemed. There is no eternal life without him. You do know that. Yes? Yes, thank you. That is certainly the truth in your heart. Without the power of the Holy Spirit, who raised Christ Jesus from the dead, we are hopelessly lost. Without the power of the Holy Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead, you are hopelessly lost. But in God, through God, he is able to establish us in Christ Jesus. Now, we can have an easy way to please God. But without God establishing us, some try to please God with works. I'll be ministering, God will be really pleased when you'll pat me to the back. Without him, it will come to nothing. You know that without him, our works are nothing. Our righteousness is described, our self-righteousness is described as dirty rags. And yet we can't be saying, well, I got my best done. God sees it as dirty rags without him. We need to allow him to cleanse us and make us white as snow. Allow him to establish us, to forgive us, to adopt us as his children. You know you can stand on your head, and that doesn't impress you much. If you could, but you can't, you could fly like an angel. That wouldn't impress God. That doesn't impress him. We can quote the Bible verse the verse cover to cover. But without the power of God establishing us, without us bowing our hearts and our wills before Him. Without us surrendering ourselves to Him and saying, "Well, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I need you." Because of nothing. I knew a fellow. I met a fellow who knew Scripture better than I do. His name was Dawg. He knew Scripture, but he had never accepted Christ Jesus as his Savior. Knowing Scripture in and of itself is not going to get you to heaven. All the good works is not going to get you to heaven. Standing on your head is not going to get you to heaven. You're going to get to heaven through Jesus Christ, who is able to establish us. In chapter 1, and you read, "For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just will live by faith." So what can you do? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Have faith in Him. Put your faith in Him, surrender your will to Him. Be that new creation that Corinthians speaks of. For if you're in Christ Jesus, you're now a new creature. He took His power, the old has passed away, and the new has come. By the power of God, who is able to establish you, He is able. He said, "Well, I'm going to turn over a new leaf." Sure, it may be red, but it won't, but it'll come to mind. Without Him. Fulfilling the purposes of God for your life, in loving your neighbor, forgiving your enemies, living humbly before God. But it only comes in cooperation with God, who is able to establish you. Those of you who have had small children, and I was thinking of toddlers and such, there were two of them. We would need to go from where we were, and so I would get the one dress. And that's a challenge in and of itself, because you're putting the socks on one foot, the sock on one foot, the shoe on one foot, and they're busy taking the sock and the shoe off the other foot. You're putting their pants on, and they're taking their shirt off. Or is this my problem? Eventually, you struggle and struggle, and you got to be where you're going. And so you get that one dressed, and you say, "You sit right here on this couch, and you wait, and we're going to go in just a minute." And so you run into the other room, and you get the other one, and you struggle with them to get their clothes on, and you come out, and the other one's sitting in their diaper. Well, God bless you. God bless you that they were willing to cooperate with you. For us, we need to cooperate with Him as He blesses us in His righteousness, as He grows us in Jesus Christ. We ought not be shedding it as fast as He puts it on. You got to cooperate. Philippians 1 says, gives the promise that God will call us confident that He who has begun a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. However, we must cooperate in the process of Him completing that good work in us. Don't keep shedding or refusing to obey or to humble yourself or to, you're just prolonging the process. Paul, in verses 25 and 26 of Romans 16, I'll read it to you again. Actually, let's go back. "Now the hand of the Lord will establish you in accordance with my gospel, the message I proclaim about Jesus Christ, in keeping with the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all the Gentiles to come to be obedient to faith and faith. We mentioned this last week in Romans 11 as well. There are some who say that the Old Testament, the prophets, the writings, all through history, God faithfully revealed himself, that they mean nothing to us. That's not true. That's not true. The New Testament stands on the foundation of the Old. You find the promises of the Messiah in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, it simply serves to reinforce and to encourage us that God's plan was all along. In fact, you know who first, Romans 1, 17, I told you, as it is written, the just shall live by faith, that was first expressed to Abraham. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and the just will live by faith. It was first mentioned about Abraham. So when Paul says, in keeping with the revelation, that the mystery is hidden from all ages past, and not made known to the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, Paul says, so that the Gentiles may come to the obedience that comes from faith. So, what do those Jewish people bring together? Are we all Gentiles? Are you Jewish or are you Gentile? I'm Gentile. I'm Gentile. But I've been brought close by the blood of the Lamb. I have been grafted into the body of Christ, joined together. Paul commends to them the prescription, of the Word of God. How are we going to know that God loves us and that Jesus died that we might be saved? Through God's Word, if you want God to establish you in Him, do it according to God's Word. If you want all God has planned for you, it's in the Word. But once you know the Word, you know the Word, but then you got to apply the Word. You got to apply the Word. I don't remember. I stood in front of a mirror this morning. Did my hair hang down? I don't know that I paid any attention. Reading the Word and then not applying it to our lives is like looking in a mirror and then walking away without doing anything about it. You have to apply what you see, not from a mirror as according to your face, but as you peer into the Word, you have to apply that to your life. If you want Philippians 1:6 to be relevant to you, then apply God's Word to your life. Now, in Romans 16:26, this is what Paul says at the close, for obedience in the faith. Not only does his power establish us, not only does his power deliver us, his power heals us, his power comforts us, his power protects us. Can you say praise God? Thank you for that doxology. You can see why Paul is praying unto God. Now I want to tell you just one more thing. To the only wise God, be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. It's closely bound to the one in chapter 11.
And it is in verse 27, to God, to the only wise God, if you have the NIV. But other translations, to the only wise. To God, the only wise. If anyone thinks they're wise in their own eyes, you got something to learn. For God is the only wise one. So it doesn't matter because he's also the only God. So to say the only wise God, well, since he's the only God, he's the only wise God. The truth still stands, but he truly is the only wise one, and that's why James said, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Because God truly is the only one that is wise. If you're wise in your own mind, that's unfortunate. However you wish to phrase it, the one who is all wise, you realize he knows just how to do it. Just how to establish you. Just how to give you salvation. Just how to bless you with all of the riches and blessings that is available in Christ. Bringing you from death unto life. For he, the only He is able to establish you. So I say, if you don't want to have your lives, then you will be saved. Your children will be saved. Lay them down. Focus on God. If you're sick, lay it before him. For in all these things, he is good. To him be our glory through Jesus Christ.